it's a real pleasure for me to be here. As always, working with Bonnie Addario and the foundations are something that I think is incredibly important. I think what I'd like to do is to disseminate the state of the art of information on lung cancer treatment. And so I entitled it just talking a little bit about the lung cancer problem around the world. So these are the numbers for lung cancer deaths in the world, the best numbers I could get. So 1.37 million deaths per year from lung cancer, and the next highest is about half that. And it's a little hard to read here, but this is worldwide data where I've highlighted on the left is the number of cases, and on the right is the number of deaths for men and women, respectively. And so around the world, lung cancer is the number one killer of men, number one prevalent cancer and the number one killer, and it's the number two killer worldwide by a very narrow margin in women. It's also prevalent around the world in many countries, and you really can't read this, except this is just the lung cancer incidence in a variety of countries. One thing that's very clear is there is a more than tenfold regional variation in the number of lung cancers per 100,000 in different populations. And there's also huge variations in the five-year survival rates. I just picked a few example survival rates in different regions, and I actually was very surprised to see some of the European countries doing so poorly down here. Nobody does well, however, and that's one of the purposes of these kinds of meetings, to try to improve that. So this also is not easily readable, but if you look, this just lists the number one and number two causes of death for men and women in various countries. And I boxed in lung and bronchus, so you can see in individual regions of the world, in Africa, the Caribbean, Eastern Asia, Central and Eastern Europe, lung cancer is the number one or number two cause of death in almost every region for men. And it's a major player in women around the world as well, but again with a large regional variation. So as president-elect of the IASLC, one of our missions, our mission is to reduce the death and suffering from lung cancer worldwide. And as Paul Bunn likes to say, the I in the IASLC is international, and that's the way we start, and that's an underlying premise to everything that's done in the ISLC. So what the ISLC does to attack this problem includes something like this meeting that we're having right here, global and regional meetings, and our journal, the Journal of Thoracic Oncology. We have a very strict regionalization of leadership. The presidency rotates in different geographic regions. We have a diverse spread of representation on the board, et cetera. And we have not just the World Conference, but we have international and regional meetings to discuss important topics in lung cancer care, including diagnosis, screening, and tobacco control, staging and pathology and molecular analysis standards. We've published recently the new staging system for lung cancer. We're trying our best to provide research fellowships and travel support so that we can disseminate the information that we learn in one part of the world to other parts of the world and enable people who couldn't otherwise afford to do it to travel to meetings like this. And we have, I have made it a personal effort of mine to try to improve the connections of the ISLC with advocates and with foundations. So our membership is growing. right now, this most recent year is 3,600 members. I think it should be many times that, but we're making progress. It's, as I said, divided by region, about one-third Asia, about one-third Europe, and about one-third North America. And we're trying to make inroads in the South America and Asia Pacific, et cetera. The World Lung Cancer Conferences attract several thousand of people. And at this meeting here, the final number that I got yesterday was 5,200 attendees and 2,300 abstracts, which is a new record. And by the way, at the meeting, like the ASCO meeting, there's only about 500 lung cancer abstracts. So this meeting is by far and away the biggest lung cancer gathering of minds in the world. We have 93 countries represented and 160 scientific sessions at this meeting. And as I said, we have regional meetings as well in various parts of the world. And this just shows some of the ones coming up. Our journal is doing well with increased numbers of publications. We had 180,000 visitors to the site, 1.1 million page views. And we also have an aggressive program of trying to encourage trainees and developing nation allied health members with reduced membership dues. So we have a number of initiatives, as I said, staging, pathology, genetic testing, trying to develop standards for the best way to test for molecular targeted therapies. I'm going to talk about that later. We try to hold, for people who can't come to the World Conference, we're holding what we call Best of World Lung. We have our own publishing arm where we just recently published an atlas on ALK testing. We are in the process of writing our first textbook on lung cancer, and we are also publishing our 40th anniversary monograph, which is going to be presented tonight. We also have webinars online to teach people who can't get to meetings and on various important topics. These are just some of the Best of World Lung conferences we're holding in different places. We've established what we call a board of regents, trying to get involvement of various communities and countries that are relatively underrepresented, such as South Africa, Southeast Asia, Brazil. And we have a publication. We have a new IASLC Press, which I said has published these journals, a new textbook. We've given fellowship awards to a number of individuals around the world. And we have Developing Nation Awards that we've given out. So I think this is my last slide for this section. Moving forward, we need the input of everybody, from the most basic scientists to the busy clinician to the patients and advocates, on how to best make an impact on this disease. So how can the ISLC, as an international organization, really make more of an impact than it has on thoracic cancers worldwide? How can we better engage local, dedicated organizations to attack lung cancer? How can we better interact with advocacy groups and foundations to further this effort? And in order to increase our impact, I think we need to have a larger membership. So that's all I had to say there. I think it's very clear lung cancer is a huge problem worldwide. Communicating among the various researchers and affected people affected with lung cancer can only help. We have a great lecture tonight on the efforts Australia has made to impact tobacco use, which is where it all starts in the majority of cases. And I think we have a great session planned. Thank you very much.